Cause dia tahu the theory tu, you apply and then one of the way is in between. Sebab tadi tu perangai tu mungkin boleh diubah, tapi yang paling penting sekali yang tengah tu, maknanya things tu biar kalau boleh tak ada punca-punca yang ialah orang, kalau kita mana nak tahu kan dia punya background of dari segi safety tu. So the best thing is to make sure that those unsafe act and also unsafe machinery are not there for these people to cause accident and injury lah. So now we look into the human factors theory of causation. So these are the attributes extend to a chain of events, and then events ultimately caused by human error. So human factors theory ni dia ada tiga perkara dia. Satu, overload. Nah, ini last semester OPM 530, this question dia keluar. Dia tanya pasal theory of human factors theory of causation. So first we have overload, environmental factors, noise distraction, overload of internal factors, personal problem and emotional stress, overload of situational factors, unclear instruction and stress level. So all this kalau dia over sangat, dia akan probability of causing accident. Kedua ialah inappropriate response. So kadang kita dah the way how we respond to some issues. So first, like you, when you detect hazard, do what action do you take? And then another thing is when there are some safety measures being placed, why you move all those safeguards from machine and equipment. And another inappropriate response is you ignore safety. So that is within the inappropriate response. Now we look into the activities. Activities ni performing tasks without requisite training. Maknanya main buat je, you don't have a proper training. And also the problem of misjudgment on the degree of risk involved when in a given task. Still we're talking about a person who are incompetent of judging their risk. Okay, so this combination of three theories are the human factors theory. So this is how the relationship dia tu. So kat tengah-tengah human error factors, and then it distribute to the three main components. So just we glance through this overload punya issue, imbalance between person and capacity. So overload is always about capacity. Kalau orang tu maksimum boleh kerja 8 jam tapi you pulunkan dia sampai 10 jam, overload lah tu. So it's a product of natural ability, training, state of mind, fatigue, stress and physical condition, situational factors, level of risk, unclear instruction and added environmental burdens. Okay, now we look into the inappropriate responses in a given situation due to accident. So problem of detecting a hazardous condition and not correcting it. Okay, dah kita dah baca tadi. Workstation incompatibility, incompatibility of a person workstation with regard to size, force, reach, feel and similar factors can lead to accident and injuries. And human activities, we're talking about human error. So such as a person undertake a task that he do not know. Okay, tadi kita dah discuss juga. Okay, now we move to the accident incident of theory of causation. So this is actually the extension of human factors theory, which developed by Dan Peterson. So he introduced extra, which is ergonomic traps, decision to err, and system failures. So tadi ada yang tiga tu. So bawah dia ditambah human error, accident, system failure, dan juga injury damage. So you tengok kalau dalam within the overload, dia ada few additional items. So pressure tadi ada, fatigue ada, motivation ada. So ada tiga lagi, drugs, alcohol and worry, anxiety. So that also part of overload lah. So system failure, kita tengok is talking, they are talking about policy, responsibility, training, inspection and correction, and the standard being used. So for now, this is some ways of how system can fail based on the Peterson theory. So first one is policy. Kita dah banyak kali cakap pasal policy ni. So management dia tidak produce or create a policy which is comprehensive. So ayat comprehensive maknanya dia tidak menyeluruh. Ada few things that they neglect, ada few things they cover, ada few things tidak cover. They actually should cover everything lah. Management's responsibility and authority with regard to safety are not clearly defined. Maknanya siapa yang bertanggungjawab, siapa yang in charge, apa kerja-kerja dia, are not well spelled out lah. Next is safety procedures such as measurement, inspection, correction and investigation are ignored or given insufficient attention. Maknanya if there are something which is risky, they are not well documented, they are being ignored, they don't have any specific frequent checking up or maintenance or auditing. So this is the what we can consider as insufficient attention. And then employees do not receive proper orientation, maknanya training apa semua tak cukup lah. Okay. Ataupun when you come in as a new person, you are not well being well introduced to your surroundings. So you are not well aware about the safety of your workplace, which result to you being involved in accidents lah. So decision to err may be conscious based on logic or it may be unconscious. So overload, ergonomic trap, deadlines, budget factors and peer pressure can lead to unsafe behavior. So there are this syndrome, what they call it, this thing won't happen to me. So ini satu problem bila kita menganggap diri kita sentiasa selamat dan kita tend to buat tak tahu je. So this is not a good sign and this is not a good behavior lah. So we always by right should put that anything can happen to me, so I need to be extra careful within my surroundings. So often the cause of an accident cannot be adequately explained by one model or theory. So it can be a combination of a few theories tadi lah, domino theory, human factors. It can be combination of all those theories. So the actual cause may combine parts or several different models. So habis bab theories of how accident can happen. Now we move on to the another point is to look into the how we can investigate and report accidents. So the reason of conducting accident investigation, the reason is when accident occurs in the workplace, it should be investigated lah. First, we like to determine the cause so that future accident can be prevented. So you can be the example for others so that they are not involved with the same accident again. Next is to fulfill any applicable legal or regulatory requirement. So kalau you baca akta-akta tu semua ataupun standards, dia memang ada menyatakan the leads for investigation to be conducted if there are any accidents. And next is to determine the cause of the accident. And once you investigated, you know what involved, what are the damages, so you can estimate the cost. Why you need to know the cost? Definitely lah, sebab you punya duit kan. So berapa belanja dia, berapa rugi dia. And then next, to determine the compliance with applicable safety regulation. Kita tengok, kadang-kadang kita dah comply with all these regulation but still think bad things happen. So probably they are need for reviews. And then to provide information for processing workers' compensation claim. So biasalah, you kalau nak claim, kan senang boleh claim. They need some evidence of what have happened. And this evidence must be documented and reported and presented during the dia punya procedures lah. So accident analysis report are called for when any of the following circumstances result from the accident. Satu, death, loss of consciousness, professional medical treatment beyond first aid, one or more days of lost work, over and above time lost beyond the day of the accident, modification to the injury, employee's work duties beyond those that may occur on the day of the injury. So when you're going to investigate is when all accident, no matter it's a small or big, it should be all be investigated, including the near miss. Okay, if something is about almost happening, but it's a little bad, so it should be treated like an accident juga. Sebab kalau dia dah hampir-hampir nak berlaku, sebenarnya dia termasuk dalam accident punya statistics. You need to count and make sure that that issues that happen up to the level of accident lah. As soon as all emergency procedures have been accomplished, accident investigation should begin. Maknanya once you dah clear semua benda, you dah put all the blockage dan sebagainya, kita kena start investigate. Because of why? Because waiting too long can temper ataupun make the results or the evidence problem lah. So immediate investigations are more likely to produce accurate information. Maknanya lebih cepat you buat your investigation, all the information will be clear. So semua orang tengah ingat semua benda lagi, barang pun tak beralih. Okay. So your evidence is much more solid. So an immediate investigation is evidence of management commitment to prevent future accident. So a few company kadang dibuat lambat-lambat tu, dibuat tak tahu je, dibuat slow je. So that's actually being giving a reputation that how well atau how care are they to their employee. So apa yang kita nak investigate? So the purpose of an accident is an investigation is to collect the facts. So maknanya maklumat yang fakta je lah, bukan yang maklumat tipu. And it's not the main aim to find whose fault is this, whose fault is that. That's not the main reason. But the main thing is to you to look for the cause of accident. That will be the primary focus. So once you investigate, you do not really put your emphasis on identifying who could be blamed for the accident. Kita tak tengok. So who should investigate? So in the companies, the supervisors of the injured workers conduct the investigation lah. So maknanya kalau you kerja dengan you punya head of department, so your head of department will conduct the investigation, ataupun whoever being appointed as the investigator lah. So in others, safety, health and professional perform the job. So usually memang orang yang betul-betul tahu pasal safety and health. Some companies form an investigative team. As we have read before, you are required to have your SHE department. So usually they are the one who involved or in charge in looking into these matters. And also sometimes they bring in specialists if those issues are just too complicated or complex or require some professional point of view. Some factors considered in deciding how to approach accident investigation include size of company, structure of the company's safety and health program, type, seriousness and technical complexity of the accident, number of times that similar accidents have occurred, company's management philosophy and commitment to safety and health. So these are the factors considered in deciding on how to approach the investigation. So this is how the flow, 5 steps to follow in conducting an accident investigation. So you isolate the accident site from the public or from the crowd lah. So next is you record all the evidences. You tengok dan you rakam dan you ambil semua maklumat. Next, you need to have photograph, videotape. Sekarang adalah videotape maksudnya. video of the scene, and then you need to identify who's the witnesses, and then you are going to interview your witnesses. So bila you nak interview ni? Interview should begin as soon as the witness list or has been compiled and proceed expeditiously. Maksudnya kena cepat eh. Recollection will be best right after the incident. Maksudnya berlaku je accident, you terus pergi buat recollection ataupun interview. Immediacy avoid the possibility of witness comparing notes as a result changing the story. So dalam jenayah ke dalam kemalangan dan sebagainya, kita tak nak bila orang tu tengok notes, dia terpengaruh dan dia bagi cerita based on that notes pulaknya. That is not what they expect to. And witnesses should be interviewed individually and separately before they talk to each other. Why? Because kita nak tengok consistency of their stories lah. Bila dia ni cerita gini, sepatutnya the other guys are also telling the same similar story lah. Yeah, you duduk dalam satu kereta, yeah, jalan, and then something happened. So bila investigation, seorang ni cerita lain, seorang ni cerita lain, that supposed to happen lah. That will actually cause more difficulties. So interviewing witness, where to interview? The best place is at the accident scene today. So if not possible, kalau tak boleh bawa, any private setting as well. It's important to ensure that there are no distraction around and any interruption are being gathered. So it is also important to select neutral location in which business feel much more comfortable. So find a spot where both parties can discuss and be interviewed lah. Tak discuss lah, kali kita nak interview kan. And how to interview? So first we need to get your witness to relax lah. Alright, jangan dia kelang kabut pula. And they need to listen carefully of what, and kita pun kena listen juga, and record of what have been said by the witness, how it being mentioned, and what else which is not being said. So phrase questions in an open-ended manner. You buat soalan tu jangan tutup closely the topic lah. So phrase question in an open-ended format. Don't lead witness with your questions or influence them with gestures, facial expression, tone of voice, or any other form of non-verbal. Maknanya kita tak boleh influence, dipengaruh. Maknanya kita harap dia mention think differently. Kita buat soal garang dia, so that dia mempengaruhi di witness to say otherwise lah. Contoh macam kat dia nampak orang ni langgar. Jadi kita kata kita duduk agah-agah dia tukar pula statement dia. So that was supposed to happen. Following up an accident investigation, it is important to follow up quickly once an accident investigation has been completed. Follow up step once an accident investigation is complete, including the following. Satu, you kena buat write up the accident report. Develop a plan for corrective action. Implement the corrective action plan. Monitor and evaluate the effectiveness of correction action. Adjust as necessary to ensure the cause of incident has been eliminated. The next, how you report an accident. The accident should be culminate in a comprehensive accident. Maknanya, report tu mesti report yang full. You tak boleh ada separa-separa. You need to record all the findings of the accident investigation. What causes the accident? And what will be the recommendation for corrective action. Ini tak sama dengan kemalangan jalan raya yang kita report ke polis sebagainya, tapi dalam konteks company lah. What happen, katalah warehouse tu roboh ke, pecah ke sebab forklift terlanggar kan. So you investigate and you report what caused the accident, and the last thing is you recommend on how you ensure that it doesn't happen again, and what have been action been taken lah. That's the corrective action. Next is topic on why some accidents are not reported. So this is common issue juga lah. Maknanya accident berlaku tapi nampak macam tak berlaku, sebab apa? It's not reported. So the reason is red tape. Some people see paperwork involved in accident reporting as red tape to be avoided. Ignorance. Not all managers or supervisors know as much as they should be about reason for accident reporting. So banyak yang ignorance, eh, maknanya dia anggap benda tak penting dan ataupun dia tak tahu langsung pasal keperluan untuk report accident. Next is due to embarrassment. A supervisor manager who did not properly supervise, train or provide proper training will be embarrassed to file a report. Next is record spoiling. So some accidents are reported to preserve a safety record, such as accident free days work. Fear of repercussion, maknanya dia takut any backlash to them. Maknanya bila report naknya, nanti kena buang kerja, kena label accident prone or subject to other negative repercussion. And next is no feedback. Some accidents go unreported because those involved feel fine, but it's a waste of time. Ni mangsa dia, kadang dia selfish lah pada saya, selfish dan tidak memiliki sama, so dia are giving no feedback, no feedback at all. Ni problem juga. So ni a few theories of incident yang ada. Domain theory, loss causation model, multi casualty, the human factor, incident accident theory, epidemiology theory of incident, system theory of incident, and combination. So you can browse Google through all these theories yang ada about accident. One thing for you to know, cuma kita cover dalam ni ialah dominant theory and the human factors. Yeah. Alright. So ni tak ada. So summary bit about this topic. Okay. So that's it for my lecture on accident topic. This is a quick one, a short one. I will also pass it to you some question for you to answer, so that I know that you actually here to my talk here today. And if you listen to this, I will also include a short quiz for you in Ireland. You need to answer that question. That's a proof that you have actually gone to these videos and considered as attending this class. Alright, so with that, thank you very much for your kind attention. Wabillahi taufiq wa hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And stay safe. Keep yourself hygiene. And doa that this outbreak are being put to stop. Okay, see you again in next class. Assalamualaikum.